Every death that occurs from an asbestos exposure could be prevented.
Don't be fooled. There is a connection.
Everything just ties together.
I don't know what I can do.
It's hard to describe what ADAO has been in my life. I certainly can't imagine it without ADAO.
We've come a long way, and I'm really proud of ADAO.
Keep me in your heart for a while.
Hi, Linda. It was a little more than a month ago. I spent Thanksgiving in Italy. This is Stephan Schmidheiny. He's the sixth wealthiest man in Switzerland. And he inherited the Eternit business from his family. At the age of 29, he became the chief officer of the biggest asbestos cement manufacturing company in Europe, with plants all over Europe and with factories as well in Latin America and in South Africa. And Mr. Schmidheiny was running the business from the time he was 29 years old in 1976. And he is worth, according to Fortune magazine, $2.8 billion. He's the criminal defendant.
Can we get him to clean up the envelope?
Well, I was just thinking that Linda Murray is the only one so far who's talked about criminality. I consider that the elements of prevention are information, regulation, compensation, humiliation, and incarceration. So I'm going to talk about the fifth category. Okay, so the Italians have this wonderful attitude that death on the job is investigated as a possible case of manslaughter. And they have actually put businessmen in jail for workers dying making chemical dyes. In 132 workers died of bladder cancer from handling well-known dye intermediates long associated with causing bladder cancer. And they've also put people in jail for the Seveso disaster. The plant manager who was running a plant that blew dioxins all over the town of Seveso in northern Italy, which happened to be a factory owned by Hoffmann La Roche, Switzerland, exporting all the products to Switzerland and the United States, but using northern Italy as the toilet where they were going to manufacture this dangerous chemical. 7 years after they built the plant, it blew dioxins all over town. It was a big scandal. Hundreds of women had abortions because this stuff is so teratogenic. And this was quite a scandal in Italy in the 1970s. Mr. Schmidheiny is being prosecuted. And maybe eventually we'll figure out how to get this thing to work. Anyway. So I was asked to testify to present a kind of global perspective on the Schmidheiny case. And what the Eternit Enterprises, and Mr. Schmidheiny in particular, is accused of are exposing people to mortal hazards that they could have prevented using reasonable precautions and steps. We had limited amounts of documents on Eternit. Eternit had never done business in the United States, and so they had never been subject to legal discovery here. But we had some Eternit documents from the Turner and Newell files and from the Johns Manville archives. And these documents were some of the things that I presented at the trial. They only held the trial on Monday, so I told people I was a tourist in Turin who testified as an expert witness between 9:30 and 2:30 on Mondays. I was there for two Mondays to testify because I didn't get finished the first time. When I originally showed up, they provided me with a terrible translator. I knew it was bad, but I didn't know how bad it was until another translator came along and volunteered to do the second day. And she listened to the audio recording and said that he had not only screwed up some of my answers, but even he had screwed up some of the questions that they had asked me, and the judges were expressing frustration that I wasn't answering their questions, all in Italian. So I didn't know it at the time. So anyway, the documents that I presented related to the issue of warnings to workers. In 1971, there was a meeting with consultants to Johns Manville in the United States, the big asbestos company, with one of the Schmidheiny's, I think this was Max Schmidheiny, and they met at his villa in Switzerland, according to the notes. And the notes record that Mr. Schmidheiny and his associates were complaining that the president of Johns Manville had just decided to put warning labels on sacks of asbestos. They weren't very scary warnings. They were drafted by lawyers to minimize liability. So they said, breathing asbestos dust in excessive quantities for long periods of time may be damaging to your health. Didn't say whether they're talking about a cough or cancer in terms of the damage to your health. The warning label was deliberately non-scary. They wanted to fulfill their legal cover their liabilities without losing any sales. So this is what the kind of language that the lawyers came up with. Even that upset Mr. Schmidheiny. We also presented documents. Yes. Okay. Right. So next slide, please. Okay, thanks. Well, I can do it if this will work. Okay, so they're charged with not doing what they could have done to protect people. The trial was announced. The investigation began in 1999, and they didn't. That's the prosecutor, Mr. Guariniello. He's famous in Italy, well known. I mean, the idea of prosecuting businessmen is pretty special to Italy. And Guariniello has hired a special accountant to track the money trail so that they could charge the top executives and owners this time, not just the plant manager in Italy. And this is what is a kind of breakthrough in this case. And I was brought in by the people in Casale Monferrato, which is a community where Eternit operated a plant from 1906 to 1986 and caused an enormous amount of devastation in the workforce and in the nearby and the surrounding community. The Eternit documents that I discussed were correspondence with Ernst Schmidheiny to his Dutch subsidiary back in 1950, talking about asbestosis, which came up from the investigations of the Dutch subsidiary. The 1971 memo I told you about him complaining about the, Max Schmidheiny complaining about the health warnings on Johns Manville sacks of asbestos going to Europe. Then a transcript of an asbestos information groups meeting where the propaganda groups for the asbestos industry in the various countries met. There had been only one such group in 1969. By 1971, there were 11 countries that had asbestos propaganda groups, including the Asbestos Information Association in the United States. And they talked about how there were big problems with union unrest and bad publicity and government regulations coming down in England and in the United States and in Holland, but things were still quiet in Italy. So I wanted to read that to the judges in Turin. But they were warning, the Brits were warning that this is coming your way. You people in your other countries, you better look out because you better get a company line organized and let's organize ourselves internationally. By 1975, they set up the Asbestos International Association. And in 1978, Mr. van der Rest of Eternit in Belgium was recorded in an AIA memo saying to the Brits that they were starting to put take care with asbestos warning labels devised by Hill and Knowlton for the British asbestos industry. They were going to start putting those warnings on products, and the van der Rest of Eternit is saying, don't send any warning labeled products to Europe. And then in 1980, another correspondence from Eternit to the top people at Turner Renewal in England complaining that they were now starting to put cancer warnings on their sacks of asbestos from some of their mines. And the guy from Turner Renewal responded, he said, you have no idea, selling asbestos cement products in Europe, what we are dealing with the liability situation in America. These documents are consistent with the fact that Eternit did not put warning labels on their products. They sold these asbestos cement products straight through the 1980s. And I don't think they ever put warning labels on them. And in my final statements to the court, I said that this is their fundamental crime, was the failure to warn on the basis of that, all of the other crimes were built. Can somebody forward the slide, please? Thanks. So I mentioned that I had a poor translator that was in the newspapers. Then we got a new translator and a summary. So I wrote a summary of the first day's evidence that I had been unable to convey to the three judges. And we had that translated into Italian, about 3.5 pages, so that they had a good record. And again, nobody's explaining to me what the procedure is. So I'm sitting there with three copies of this statement. None of the lawyers are saying, we move this into evidence, Your Honor. So finally, I just turned to the judges and said, these are copies of my summary from last week. And they said, oh, thank you very much. No objections to it being entered into evidence. I mean, I'm completely disoriented, not knowing what in the world is the procedure, but finally just handed this stuff to the judges along with my CV. I had a copy for each one. They hadn't put my CV into evidence either, the people who brought me in. I don't know how you bring an expert in to talk to a bunch of judges and don't think to do that. Next slide, please. So the second day, I was focusing on two things. I talked about corporate documents in the United States showing that all the way back in the 1950s, American companies were talking about warning labels on asbestos-containing products. And the motivation for them doing this is because we have product liability in the United States, and if you sell products that have lethal, delayed, non-obvious dangers, and people get killed using your products, you are financially responsible for what happens to them. And this is unique to the United States, almost. This kind of public health protection doesn't exist in Europe, and accordingly, one doesn't see these kinds of things going on in Europe. And then in the late 1960s, the asbestos cement producers, the companies in the United States that made the same products Eternit was making, are also talking about warnings, also in the context of reducing liability. All of this is before we have OSHA, before we have the EPA. This is still the Wild West era of asbestos use in America, but because of product liability, these companies are focusing on their duty to warn, at least in their private discussions. And then in 1969 in Britain and in 1972, asbestos regulations came out. The American regulations required warning labels, specific language warning labels on products like asbestos, cement, sheet, and pipe. And so I brought in a contrast to the court. I said, look, they had to put warnings on these kinds of products in the US, but they had no economic penalty for failing to put warning labels on these products in Europe. And so they just continued selling them straight through the 1980s with no warning labels. So next slide, please. So I put that into the supplemental statement. Next slide. This is a chair made of asbestos cement that was on some website that we thought we'd put into the... That's the last one. Okay, so we kind of threw this slideshow together in a hurry. So I just wanted to say that the court is expected to finish hearing the evidence in this case some Monday next month, and we are hoping that within a couple of months, hopefully, they will decide. Herr Schmidheiny can stay out of jail for two more appeals to courts that go all the way up to one in Rome. I think there's a half-decent chance that the trial court is going to find him guilty, in which case he would actually be facing a 12-year jail term penalty. Under Italian law, even if they could apprehend him, he wouldn't have to serve until after his appeals are exhausted. But the publicity over this and possible extradition demands for Mr. Schmidheiny would certainly be helpful in our efforts to raise public awareness about the truly criminal nature of the asbestos industry, not just today in the developing world, but for many decades in the industrial world. Thank you.
But thanks for coming, and thanks for making this the most successful conference thus far. Keep me in your heart for-